بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم. صباح الخير جميعا. استسمحكم فانكم تقفلوا الموبايل او تحطوه على ساكن لو سمحتوا. Good morning ladies and gentlemen. My name is يحيى زكي. I'm one of the assistant of Dr. اسماعيل سراج الدين. On behalf of Dr. سراج الدين and the staff of the Library of Alexandria, it is an honor to present today our speaker, Professor George Saliba. George Saliba is a professor of Arabic and Islamic science at the Department of Middle East and Asian Languages and Cultures, Columbia University, New York, where he has been working in 1973. Dr. Saliba's age, I did not find. I think he was born 1952 or something like that. And we'll find out. Everybody is free to judge. Now, Dr. Saliba received his BSc in science, mathematics, from the American University at Beirut, and then a Master of Arts from the American University of Beirut also. He earned a master of degree in Semitic languages. There is a big transformation from mathematics to Semitic languages. And then from a doctorate of Islamic science from the University of California, Berkeley. It is a combination between mathematics, Semitic languages, and then Islamic science. Three different topics: mathematics, language, and Islamic science. This combination is unique because it has produced a lot of work on how what he says about himself. I study the development of scientific ideas from late antiquity till modern times, with a special focus on the various planetary theories that were developed within the Islamic civilization and the impacts of such theories on early European astronomy. Saliba has been doing research about possible transfer of mathematical and astronomical knowledge from the Islamic world to Europe during the 15th and 16th centuries. Well, he has a lot of publication. He has 8 books on the subject, about 200 publications on this particular topic. This combination is unique, and he is a good orator. He was Lebanese born, so he has a Middle Eastern charm, which is, as you all know, is something we appreciate, and a lot of knowledge. So please welcome with me Dr. George Saliba.
Thank you very much for not revealing my age, because I like to keep it as a secret. Since I have been here in Alexandria, I've been trying to learn how to open these bottles. But then I discovered that they have a little white strap. This little white strap is the secret key to everything. Good, now I can have some water and we will need that. Well, let me first start by thanking my very dear friend, Dr. Sirajuddin, who I think we got to know each other more than 30 years ago now. And now that I learned, since I've been here in Alexandria, this is the second time, that nothing moves in Alexandria without Sirajuddin's approval. So now I am very happy to be here. I also want to thank Dr. Omar Fikri, who was the first one to call me and say, we would like you to come to Alexandria and talk to us. And I was very graciously accepted, and I'm very happy to be here. I also would like to thank Dr. Miqati, who comes apparently from a very old, nice Miqati, is definitely a good family of astronomers who actually use their astronomy into the service of society. So I know that she is not here, but I thank her anyway because she officially sent me the invitation. But particularly I would like to thank three people. Rola Amin, without her efficient arrangement, nothing would have happened. I wouldn't have managed to be here, and I wouldn't have secured my return back. Sarah, who has been taking care of me everywhere I need anything, she solves all those problems. And I think it is Rehab, who also manages to make sure that my ticket is all there. All of those people are the oil that makes this whole place and this whole thing run smoothly. So I thank them, and I'm very happy to be here. The title of my talk that I put up on the board, I will give you the conclusions from now so that you have a choice. If you want to leave, you can leave. Or if you want to sleep, you can also do that and be comfortable. What I would like to do is to actually demonstrate with evidence. And I beg you to always pay attention to evidence. It doesn't serve anybody any good to just brag about a glorious past when we really don't have the evidence for it. And the evidence is an extremely crucial thing that we should all pay attention to. Two things I would like to demonstrate to you today. The first myth that says that Arabic Islamic science only preserved the Greek sciences so that they could be passed on to Europe is, as you will see, a very genuine myth that should be destroyed, and we will see how the evidence can actually destroy it. The second piece of mythology that we should also try to dispel is the mythology that the European Renaissance, sui generis, on its own, out of the blues, created this whole phenomena that we call modern science. So, with the talk, I would like to be able to demonstrate to you that none of these conclusions are really valid, and hence we have enough evidence to cast doubt on them at least. Now, first I want to say something about this Islamic Arabic material. And the terminology is a little bit difficult because the culture itself was difficult. In other words, we are talking about a culture that encompasses a geographical span larger than any other empire human civilization had ever known. Very few people actually take the map and lay down the extent of the geography all the way from Spain to Samarkand in Central Asia down to India. And then you can see that you can easily fit the empire of Alexander, the Roman Empire, and all other empires right within it, and you still have some extra space to fill. So this huge empire, of course, naturally encompassed a lot of people who are not Arabs and a lot of people who were not Muslims. But hence, the culture created as a result of this expansion created this amalgamation, this cosmopolitanism right within its structure. Hence, it is very difficult to designate a specific term that will fit all of the descriptions in all instances. I use the term Arabic, and I never use the term Arab. I use Arabic as a designator of the language because the people who wrote within that civilization, especially on theoretical subjects, the kind of subjects that I'll be talking about in a little while, were really written in Arabic. I use the term Islamic simply also as a designator of the cultural production. Of course, the influence of Islam on that is included, as you will see very, very soon. And hopefully, when I use these terms, Arabic and Islamic, I hope you'll understand what I mean. I also use the term critical in two different senses, as I used it in the title. The first is a positive sense of critical, and the second is a negative sense. In the negative sense, I use it to mean that Arabic civilization, Arabic Islamic civilization, was critical of the Greek scientific tradition in the negative sense, to say that they really, the scientists who work within the Islamic civilization, found fault in the ancient Greek tradition, and they corrected it, and sometimes they created alternative avenues for the same kind of scientific phenomena that they wanted to discuss. So in that sense of critical is to disapprove and to actually correct what was going on. Second sense of critical is to when you speak of something as critically important in the sense that it is absolutely essential. And that I will apply the role of Islamic science when it was being incorporated into the work of the Renaissance scientists and the kind of critical role that Islamic astronomy at the time, or Arabic astronomy, whatever you want to call it, that it played in the construction of the mind of the Renaissance scientists. These, I hope, I will demonstrate them to you with enough details. I will also speak about the phenomena that we rarely talk about it, but we should expose it a little bit more to scrutiny, is that we all have the idea that science is a phenomenon that is culture-free, because we always use that example. 2 + 2 = 4, whether it is in Japanese, Chinese, Arabic, Hebrew, whatever you want to do it. Science is not always 2 + 2. We will see that as it crosses borders, scientific ideas sometimes themselves get transformed, and sometimes they transform the culture that they go into. So as a result, this culture component within the scientific thinking is an extremely important component, and we will see, I hope I will be able to show you, that it was extremely productive, and this engagement with the culture is extremely useful. The first issues that I want to raise is the scientific response to Islam here as a religion, meaning religion itself actually necessitated the production of specific scientific trends, and we will follow some of them together. In the Quranic verse that appears from the Baqarah 232-38, of course all of you know how to read the Arabic, the English is for those who don't know it, and simply says, حافظوا على الصلوات والصلاة الوسطى وقوموا لله قانتين. Now that concept of the Salat al-Wusta caused a whole lot of commentaries among the Mufassirin, and of course the most important facts that we all know that for a practicing Muslim you have the 5 daily Muslim prayers, and the most commonly accepted interpretation of the Salat al-Wusta is that you have the 2 earlier Salats, that of the Fajr and the Dhuhr, and then the Asr is the 3rd, and of course 2 after it. So if you have 2 prayers in the morning, 2 prayers in the evening, it is this one in the middle that would probably interpret the word wusta correctly. So this Salat al-Asr becomes the focal point. The other times of prayers are easily determinable, but the Asr prayer becomes a little bit more intriguing because of the following phenomena. When the Muslim community was still in Mecca, and here I have the map for you so that you could see. I hope you can see it from here. Yeah, that's where Mecca is. And the latitude is about 21 degrees and 43 minutes in here. And in that area here, it was easy to define the Salat al-Asr as the time when the shadow of a human being is equal to his height or her height, to the time when the shadow is equal to twice the height. So that definition that applied in the area of Mecca would actually work, and might even work all the way till about Medina, where you get to the Tropic of Capricorn, which is about 23 degrees and a half. We will revisit that 23 degrees and a half. Beyond that, by the time you get to Damascus, and the Muslims got to Damascus very quickly, by the way, by 634, 635 of the Christian era, they were there. By that time, you will find that there will be many, many days during the year, especially around the winter solstice, where the shadow will never be equal to the human height. It will always be much longer. And during the winter time, as you will see in a little while also, the rays of the sun are much lower on the horizon, and hence the shadow will extend too far. Does that mean when you reach to Damascus, you stop the Salat al-Asr? So what do you do? Then the definition was ameliorated. In other words, the religion reacted to the conditions on the ground, to the mathematical geography, and the scientists also reacted to the religion. They said the definition now should be that we will take it to mean that whatever was the shadow at noon, plus the height of the person, to the time, whatever the shadow was equal at noon, to twice the height of that person. So we will include here this constant, well, this variable, which is the shadow of the at noon, and hence we can add to it whatever we want from there on. So this way it will guarantee that no matter where you are on the globe, you will be able to pray within the limits of the shadow of one person's height to twice the shadow of that. But that immediately created a problem. What is the shadow of the sun, of the gnomon, at noon? What is the length of that shadow? And as you can see, very quickly, if you take that sentence seriously, the Salat is such a simple, direct order. It says pray. And pray under those conditions. But the minute you tie it to shadows, you are tying it already to astronomical phenomena and to mathematical geography. Now you can see very quickly, to be able to define the length of the shadow at noon, you drop in here to find the equation, and now you have the length of the person times the cotangent of the height of the sun at noon. First thing, there is no cotangent in the Greek scientific tradition. Okay? The trigonometry of the whole Greek scientific tradition depends only on one theorem, which is the Menelaus theorem, and it does not include such concepts as sine, cosines, tangents, cotangents, and the likes. So the scientists who first tried to expand the definition of the height of the sun at noon and the length of the shadow had to create this new function that is called the cotangent. So from the very beginning, you see the scientists responding already by creating new science to be able to do that. Then the height of the sun at noon itself is actually a phenomenon that we know how to compute it. It is the complement of the latitude of wherever you are on the earth, and that means it's dependent on the city that you live on, plus the minus the declination of the sun on that day. You are already involved in very sophisticated mathematical astronomy from the very beginning to just know, when am I going to pray? That simple Asr prayer, okay? But you are commanded to do it. Okay, let me explain it a little bit so that you'll understand what it entails. Once you begin to take these things seriously, the consequences of them become extremely important. Now, we know that the sun moves on this ecliptic, which is the dark circle that we see it in here, and from day to day, the sun supposedly caught at this point here, it revolves all around in 24 hours. So as a result, the sun will describe a shadow at noon, cast from here over there, and it will give us this angle h sub n here, which is the height of the sun at noon. But we notice that from day to day, this height changes, because the next day the sun is going to be here, and hence you have a different height. Also, we notice that this angle that is between the equator, as you see it there, and the ecliptic, this epsilon angle here, is a fixed value, meaning the inclination of the ecliptic is a fixed value. And hence, now when we look at the angle delta, that is the variation in the declination of the sun on daily basis, then you will see that this formula here really depends on two, meaning the height of the sun at noon, on two other variables. One of them can be easily determined by direct observation, which we can see it from here. Anywhere you are, the height of the North Pole over your local horizon is the latitude of your city. The complement of that, meaning up to 90 degrees, is the so-called phi bar. This you observe it once, you make that determination. From there on, the only variable that remains is delta. You need to know from day to day how much is the distance between the equator and the circle of the sun, this delta measurement that reaches a maximum here and becomes epsilon as here. Of course, now we have a triangle that has the longitude of the sun. The sun moves day to day on this and hence creates a small delta here, a bigger delta there, and the maximum delta over here. This is the fixed epsilon in here. To solve for delta, we have to resort to this equation, which says the sine of delta is equal to sine of lambda multiplied by the sine of epsilon, which now comes from where? It comes from a law that we now refer to as the sine law. Again, There is no sign law in the Greek tradition. There is no sign law in the Indian tradition from which the Arabic Islamic civilization drew a lot of its scientific material. So here again, we have the scientists within the Islamic civilization creating new trigonometric laws to be able to solve for this variable delta, which is the very easy, as you can see, it's a very easy component of this right spherical triangle that we have here. And hence, the introduction of new trigonometry is from the very beginning embedded within the simple statement that says you should start your Asr prayer at this time and end it in this other time. So already the trigonometry is built in. Remember, we said that this epsilon is a fixed value. This inclination between the ecliptic and the equator is a fixed value, and it can also be observed. And the observation that was normally done was to take the following. If you set up any wall from the south-north direction, and then you sit a peg or any straight rod into that wall, the shadow of that wall at the summer solstice, when the sun reaches its highest position, will be cast at this point. And when it is a winter solstice, you will see that it casts the shadow at this point. The difference between those two is the maximum variation that the shadow will make between the winter solstice and the summer solstice. You take these two shadows, you divide them by half, the value in between is indeed the value of epsilon. So what you needed to do is actually be able to measure with some precision the length of this arc so that you can determine it by two. Here the term precision is extremely important. The measurements, as we will see, that were made in the Greek tradition or in the Indian tradition were both erroneous because they were not precise. The precision depended on the sizes of the instruments, and hence the size of the instruments that were proposed in the Islamic tradition was to actually magnify this arc as much as possible so that you can get the fine readings as to what is this point and what is this other point in order to be able to determine the midpoint. Some archaeological remains of this huge arc are still in Samarkand up till today in the observatory of Ulugh Beg, who, by the way, is the only ruler politician, only, including Al-Ma'mun, by the way, he is the only ruler politician who knew something about science and who actually participated in the construction of the observatory and even participated in the classroom discussions. He would visit the class discussion and would interrupt the students as they were reading astronomical texts to say, what does this sentence mean? All other politicians since then, they only know how to sell themselves for the next elections. So Mr. Ulugh Beg, the construction of this quadrant here is still a monument to the two phenomena, that the size of instruments are extremely important. That's why don't believe anybody who will tell you the little astrolabes that you see in the museums are good observational instruments. That's utter nonsense. What you will get from those little astrolabes are angles plus or minus 5 degrees or so. You really don't get precisions from them. You need a whole quadrant this size to be able to get very fine results. As a result, with these improved instruments, with this precision concept overriding, they managed to measure the inclination between the ecliptic and the equator to be a value of 23 degrees and a half or so. The fact that this measurement is absolutely precise is the fact that we still use it up till now. This measurement was made in Baghdad between the years 830 and 835 in a group of observations that were all surrounded around the court of Al-Mutawakkil, and probably it's headed by a group of astronomers, mathematicians, three brothers called the Banu Musa. There's Muhammad ibn Musa ibn Shakir and his brother Al-Hassan and his third brother Al-Ahmad. Those apparently were the ones who sponsored a whole lot of activities, including such measurements. The fact that we still use it, I say, is a testimony to the precision that they managed to achieve at that time. More so, I want you to compare it, this value of 23 and a half, compare it with the Greek value, which is 23 degrees, 51 minutes, and 20 seconds. It's about 20 minutes too large. And the Indian tradition that says it is 24 degrees, which is about half degree too large. Now people will probably say that, oh, you are tinkering over little half a degree or 20 minutes, what difference does it make? Let me remind you that you are playing with concepts that gave rise to this humongous concept called astronomical numbers. You know those astronomical numbers, they have lots of zeros on both ends when you multiply them. So if you get half a degree and end up multiplying it by huge numbers, you will end up getting a very large mistake. To give it differently, if I accept donations in the amount of very small 1/4 piaster in the Egyptian money, I will accept donations of 1/4 piaster, very little money that you can't even find it anymore. But allow me to accept donations from 10 to the power 6 of people of 1/4 piaster each, I will become richer than Bill Gates. So small numbers, when you multiply them by very large numbers, they actually produce tremendous amounts of errors. So this value of 23.5 is indeed an improvement, and an extremely important improvement over the earlier observation. The second thing that we needed to do, if you remember the triangle that we started with here, we needed to determine epsilon so that we can, the combination that we have it here, and then the second we needed to determine lambda. Epsilon we just determined, now we need to determine lambda as we go. Ptolemy had made a determination of meaning, where is the position of the sun every day, with respect to us who are sitting here on the earth, that he knew that the sun is not running around us and we sitting in the center of the circle. The reason is that during the spring and summer time, the sun seems to take a longer time to pass that quarter here and that quarter, and in the winter time, it seems to move rather fast. How does this get reflected in our daily life? We all remember that the months of July and August, both of them are 31 days, meaning the sun is lingering up in the sky during those months much longer than the time in the winter, when February is only 28 days. So you can see we steal the days from February as a reflection that the sun is moving rather fast when it is in the winter time. And this simply means that the sun is moving on a circle whose center is a little bit away from the earth. This distance, ZE, is called the eccentricity, meaning is the distance of the circle of the sun away from us on the earth, and hence he needed to determine that value, ZE. He wanted to do it by making the following observations. He wanted to determine those arcs, meaning when does the sun reach the vernal equinox, i.e. The time when it is at zero Aries, and when is the sun at the solstice, and when is the sun at the autumnal equinoxes. This way he will count the days it takes to cover that, and hence with the simple computations he can determine ZE from it. But look at the difficulty. The difficulty with the method is that during the time when the sun gets to the solstices, meaning around 90 degrees or about 270 degrees, there will be few days where the declination of the sun will not be detected along this axis here. So in other words, the sun will look like it is fixed in that position, and hence we would not know exactly where is the midpoint when the sun has reached the solstice. What does it mean also in daily life? This is something, a phenomenon that even the peasants up in the field, they know about it. Meaning, if you look now at the sunrise on a specific spot on your local horizon, you will notice around this time of the year, we have just passed the summer solstice, around this time of the year, the sun will rise from almost the same spot on the horizon. But then, towards the middle of August or so, you will notice that the sun, every few days, it moves back towards the direction of the south. So it will not rise from the same spot anymore. But those 4 or 5 days around the summer solstice, when the sun rises from the same spot and sets on the same spot, are very difficult to determine the point in between. Hence, to get the precision again as to when did the sun reach the summer solstice. Muslim astronomers also in the same group under the Banu Musa grouping determined that this is a very poor method, that what Ptolemy had done
was a very poor strategy as to when to observe. In fact, what he should have done is to observe in the middle of the seasons when the variation of this arc from day to day is easily noticeable in the declination here, and here too, and all of the middle of the seasons, it will be a much better strategy to observe. So these people were not criticizing the Greek tradition because it's Greek. They were criticizing it because it was scientifically insufficient. It was scientifically deficient, and hence they needed to create better values, but also better strategy of observations, better methodology of science, and they produced this method that is called the Fusul method, i.e. the middle of the seasons method, that will give them a better account of that eccentricity. Hence, they took the same problem as the eccentricity that was to be determined by Ptolemy, now used fresh observations, but notice they observe now in the middle of Taurus, they in the middle of Leo, and in the middle of Scorpio, instead of the beginnings of the seasons and the end of the season, and now they could get a much better value for the eccentricity easy, because they could get a much, much finer results of the observations. This, incidentally, gave them also a bonus. Once you do these things, not only did they determine EZ correctly, they determined that the farthest point, which is called the solar apogee in here, was not fixed, as Ptolemy had told us. Ptolemy had said that this point H in here is fixed in the sky. The solar apogee does not move, according to Ptolemy, and he said it's fixed at 5.5 degrees of Gemini. By the time they were making the observations in Baghdad about 700 years later, they discovered that if it were fixed, it would still be at 5.5 degrees of Gemini. Instead, they found that this apogee here was already about 17, 18 degrees of Gemini. So it has moved already about 11 to 12 degrees. So as a result, as a bonus, they determined that the solar apogee indeed moves. And hence, now you politely reject the Ptolemaic observations, you reject the Greek tradition, and you build a new tradition to say that the solar apogee now moves at the same rate as precession. Precession is a phenomenon that's very difficult to explain because there are almost contradictions in terms. In the Arabic tradition, it's simply called harakat al-kawakib al-thabita. Well, if they were thabita, how could they move? Simply what it means is that the whole constellations up in the skies, they seem to slide backwards with respect to the vernal equinox. Hard concepts, but if you look them up, you will find that in the Greek tradition, that motion of the constellations was supposed to be at the rate of 1 degree per 100 years. This gave rise, by the way, to the musical play called Hair, in which there is a song that says, this is the age of Aquarius, if you remember. Simply to say that the vernal equinox has crawled back and is now in Aquarius on the computation of 1 degree every 100 years. Now that they have determined that the solar apogee is tied to that precession, they found out that that precession is not 1 degree every 100 years. In fact, it is 1 degree every 70 years or so. So it's a much faster motion. And hence, another fundamental parameter of the Greek tradition has collapsed. But now that they know the apogee, they know the eccentricity, this is the value of the eccentricity, now they can determine lambda, because from this configuration we can see that lambda, the position of the sun, the real position for a person on the earth, is the position of the mean value, which is the lambda bar, plus or minus a correction that we call the equation of the sun. Here again, built into this formula, the equation determined by the tangent inverse, the sine over cosine, all of those are sophisticated trigonometric values that they needed to do before you can actually determine where is this lambda and solve back the original problem as to how high or how long is the shadow at noon so that you can determine the Asr prayer. So as a result, to just determine when to pray, especially for the Asr prayer, you manage to correct the inclination of the ecliptic. You manage to also find out that the motion of the solar apogee is contrary to the Greek tradition. you managed to find out that the rate of precession from the Greek tradition is invalid, and hence you need a new value for the precession. You managed to find that the solar eccentricity is not 2.5 parts as Ptolemy has said, but it is more like 1 part and 59 minutes. And as I said, small values in astronomy are extremely important. And you managed to also find a new solar equation. All of those, when you add them all up, this is the sum total of the basic fundamental parameters of astronomy. Not a single parameter survived from the Greek tradition. So what is it when people tell us that Arabic astronomy was simply protecting and passing on the Greek astronomy so that somebody brighter than them could pick it up in Renaissance Europe? Every single parameter, as you notice, was already destroyed, and it was replaced by a much more refined parameter. And as I said, the test is that the new parameters are still with us up till today. The second requirement of the prayer. You simply, again, here again, I'm illustrating the power of culture onto science, that it is requiring from science, and by culture here, I mean the religion of that culture as well, that now the science has to respond to it. And of course, for the prayers, you are instructed in the Quranic verse here, وَحَيْثُمَا كُنْتُمْ فَوَلُّوا وُجُوهَكُمْ شَطْرَهُ. So you have to pray in the direction of Mecca. That is a simple, nice, innocent statement. But you take it seriously, and look what it means. It means that if you are in the city of Cairo here, and this is the North Pole, and you are living, of course, in the spherical universe, and if this is Mecca, this great arc, great circle that goes through your zenith, through the zenith of Mecca, and through the center of the universe, will cast an angle here that you call it the Qibla of Cairo. Hence, you have to simply solve for this value Q. Yeah? You are prepared, take your pens and pencils, and begin to calculate. Okay? For the city of Mecca, meaning for your local horizon, now if you take the Cairo horizon and that is the zenith of it, this is the Q that you have to solve, and this is the spherical triangle. Now it is no longer a right angle triangle, so now it is much more sophisticated to solve it, and if you solve the elements of this right angle triangle, you'll be able, not right angle, the general spherical triangle, you'll be able to get the angle Q. Look what you have to do that. You have to create a new cosine law to be able to solve that for that Q. You have to reuse the same sine law that you have used before. You have to play with all of this trigonometry in order to fit it into this very long formula that you see over here to be able to finally get that the angle Q is, look at this, is the arc cotangent of sine times cosine of cosine times tangent divided by sine. Try to do it by hand and see if you can get it correctly. And then you will see the kind of labor those geniuses who worked in this civilization could actually do it. A muwaqqit, probably a great-great-grandfather of our Dr. Miqati, a muwaqqit actually by the name of Al-Khalili, who actually computed the qiblas of various cities for almost every single longitude line and every latitude line, got them right to within 2 minutes of arc. He actually computed them. And when we compare them with modern computer calculations, he got them within that kind of precision, meaning for every single city, for every single longitude, every single latitude, he solved an equation of this nature and managed to get it right. You try to do it one, and even I will allow you to use computers. I will allow you to use calculators. I allow my students to do that, and good 90% of them get it wrong. Because they knew also that once you can solve a difficult problem once, why do you have to solve it all the time? Record it once and then use it. And hence they knew that for a specific city, there is only one Qibla, meaning the direction of Mecca from Cairo, is not going to vary tomorrow morning. So what they did, they encoded these values for the various cities, as you see them here, on the back of astrolabes. These arcs of the astrolabes that you see them there, they have at the end of them the names of the cities. I can see Shiraz from here. I can see Baghdad right underneath it, and so on. So for every city, they drew actually a graph That's exactly what they did, and people thought that graphs were introduced only after Descartes. But please look at the back of every Islamic astrolabe. It has a graph of the direction of the Qibla for every one of those cities for every day of the year, meaning you just observe the height of the sun on every day, and here you are given the guide of the position of the sun every day, and wherever the angle on that day will read the Qibla for the city that you are in. These curves that you see them here are also records of the length of the sun, of the shadow at noon, for all of those latitudes that are marked at the edge of those curves. So they stabilized all of those solutions so that you have them like a little handbook, and they are written on the back of the astrolabe. On this side of the astrolabe, and again, there is no Greek astrolabe that have survived, but even the ones that have survived do not have, because they never needed this kind of trigonometry. Here you have the sine functions, the cosine functions here, the sine functions. This is a full grid of trigonometric tables that you see on the back of the astrolabe. On the lower part of the astrolabes, you have the tangents, the cotangents. So this machine begins to be your walking computer, and it solves all of those very sophisticated trigonometric problems and astronomical problems at the same time. They went even a step further. Once you make the solution and it works, so why not record it for posterity? They tried to generate new maps with new methods of projection, i.e., why not take the center of the world to be around Mecca and take every single city on the globe, project it along the azimuth lines, so that you get a map of this four, where every single dark spot that you see here determines a specific city. And hence, along this alidate, if you put the city here and then pass this alidate, you will read the qibla of that city along the edge in here, and along the alidate itself, you read the distance of that city from Mecca. So not only you learn where is the direction of Mecca for that particular city, you also learn how much money you have to prepare to travel to Mecca for your pilgrimage. So this map here is a quick solution for both of those problems. Both of them are generated by religious need. Religion is literally generating science now. It's forcing you to think of new ways of geometry, new ways of trigonometry, new ways of mapping, and new ways of astronomy, as we will see. But now that they have found fault with almost every single parameter in the Greek tradition, they began to ask, which is the natural question, what else was wrong in the Greek tradition? If these obvious parameters that they could easily determine were easily corrected, now there must have been something a little bit more fundamental on the theoretical level, in the same way that they found that the methodology of Ptolemy in the observations was also flawed. Now, the questions began to be a little bit more foundational, i.e. they began to question the very foundation of the cosmology of the Greek tradition. But first they started by correcting the texts, i.e. the translators that brought the Greek tradition into Arabic were not ignorant and simple language people. They were people who actually were scientists at the same time. I'll give you an example. Al-Hajjaj ibn Matar, who translated the most important text of the Greek tradition, that's called the Almagest. As he was translating it, he noticed that in the Greek text, Ptolemy says, if you take this number of days, 126,007 days and 1 hour, and divide them by this many circles of the moon, meaning rotations of the moon, 4,267, you will get this value, which is 29 days, 31 over 60 of a day, 50 over 60 squared, 8 over 6 cubed, 20 over 60 to the fourth. Well, Al-Hajjaj said, let's try it. He took this number, divided it by this. This is not the answer. There is this answer, and he recorded it, as you see here, for those who can read the numerological value of Arabic, Kaf Tah is 29, Lam Aleph is 31, Noon is 50, Ha is 8, Tah is 9, and Kaf is 20. So he says, no, the division is not this one. The division is this one, and he wrote it down correctly. So what he was doing, he was double-checking the original Greek computations that are buried into the text, and now he's producing the correct values. By the way, this turns out to be the value that was used later on by Ptolemy. I mean, I'm sorry, by Copernicus during the Renaissance. So, because it was the trusted value and it was a corrected value. More so, this value that Ptolemy gave us here, 29, 31, is not even the result of a division. Ptolemy knew that. This is the value that was inherited from ancient Babylonia. In the ancient Babylonian computations, the length of a lunar month was well known in the 3rd century, 4th century BC, to be of 29 days, 31. And that's why they are all written in sexagesimal system, meaning of powers of 60. So Ptolemy simply did not divide. He simply copied what he had seen in the ancient Babylonian records, and he smacked it right into the text as the value of the lunar month. So it was Al-Hajjaj, the translator, who says, no, we have to do it correctly, and hence he carries the divisions and he gets the better result. Now, on the more cosmological level, the Greek tradition that the astronomy of Ptolemy inherited and wanted to embody told us that if we are living at the center of the universe, which is the Earth, and there is a good argument why we are at the center of the universe, then the planets will look to us as if they are moving along a small sphere in here, but the sphere itself is buried within a larger blue sphere, and on top of it, that the larger blue sphere rotates supposedly in place, but on an axis that doesn't go through its center, on an axis that is called the equant. Well, that's a little difficult to understand. But all basketball players know the following phenomena. You know those basketball players, when they take a sphere and they pin it down on one finger, they have to make sure that this finger goes exactly through the axis of the sphere. Let me demonstrate what happens when you move that finger away, as Ptolemy would recommend. If you move it away, the sphere will collapse. So it is physically impossible, and that's extremely important, it's physically impossible for a universe to exist in the fashion that Ptolemy has described its motion. Meaning, for us to believe Ptolemy, we have to believe that there can be a sphere that moves uniformly in place on an axis that does not go through its center, as I said, nicely demonstrated by basketball players to be impossible. Hence, when that text gets translated, a lot of problems began to be recorded, and the most famous is the text that was written by Ibn al-Haytham, who lived right down the street in Cairo from here, and who wrote this famous text that he called Ash-Shukuk ala Batlamyus, doubts on the works of Ptolemy. Particularly, doubts on that cosmological question that Ptolemy was forcing us to accept, which means that now we have to have a sphere that moves uniformly on an axis that doesn't go through its center, which is physically impossible. So Ibn al-Haytham says, this cannot be the correct astronomy. He says, batila. So from there on, the main concern of Arabic astronomy, Arabic Islamic astronomy, is in fact now to create a new alternative astronomy that remains faithful to the observations. The most crucial thing is that you want to explain the observations and the phenomena around you, but at the same time, to do them by a kind of mathematics that is consistent with the physics, meaning a mathematics that does not force a physical sphere to move uniformly on an axis that goes through other than its center. That combination, that mathematics and physics have to be harmoniously together, is a requirement that was added by the Arabic Islamic tradition and is nowhere to be found in the Greek tradition. Hence the novelty. And the importance is to say that science is a harmonious body of knowledge, that we cannot in one language speak of certain physics and then come to describe it in a mathematics that violates the physics that we just proposed. Hence, we find them, one astronomer after another, now making corrections. And now, I want you to see the level of the theorization that went on. According to Ptolemy again, we are told that if we are living here on the Earth, and this is the moon here, the moon is supposed to be carried by a small sphere that is called the epicycle. But he noticed, and here the observation, the power of the observation is extremely important. In observation, he said, when the moon is in the position with the sun, or when it is a full moon in here, the maximum variation the moon will have from between the mean position and the real position of the moon, meaning the size of this epicycle, that is the, tell us here, the mean position, and that is the real position there, the maximum variation is about 5 degrees. But when the moon is about 1 week old, the variation becomes about 7.5 degrees. So how do you account, how do you make a mathematical mechanism that explains a certain object has a certain size in one position, but at another size, another position, the size has to look bigger. So what he did, he used the old trick that we all know, that the size of objects is not an absolute value. The size of this bottle is determined at a specific distance. When I bring this bottle close to my eye, it covers the whole wall behind it. Does that mean that the bottle is bigger than the wall? It simply means it's closer to me. Hence, the distance of the observer from the object is a factor that has to be taken in the apparent value of the object. So now Ptolemy did it cleverly. He says, all I have to do, if I bring this epicycle closer to the Earth, it will look bigger than this epicycle that is at the, either the conjunction with the sun or opposition to the sun. So just bring it closer, and then it will make it look bigger. That will account for the variation in the angles that he was trying to support. But look what happens. When you bring an object closer to the Earth to fill the requirements that Ptolemy was trying to answer, you brought this distance down to 39 units from the time when it was here, 60 units. So the variation between this distance and this distance is almost 2 to 1. Look what that means. It means if I bring an object half distance, it will look twice as big. As a result, the moon at quadrature, i.e. when it is a quarter moon, by Ptolemy's observations themselves and Ptolemy's model, should look this size. I drew this to scale, by the way. It should look like that. When it is full moon, it should look like this, meaning it's smaller body of the moon. Ibn Shatir says, وَلَمْ يُرَى كَذَلِكَ. I have never seen the moon at quadrature looking twice as big as the moon when it is full moon. Therefore, Ibn Shatir says, I have to create a new mathematics that satisfies the conditions of the observations and still does not reduce the size of the moon, the apparent size of the moon. And that is the proposal of Ibn Shatir, who died in 1375. So he says, if I can actually mount the moon on two epicycles and arrange the movements of those epicycles in such a way that they are lined up when it is in conjunction of the sun in this fashion, or when it is in opposition at this, then it would look smaller, but when it is at 90 degrees, I will line them up this way so that the angle they cast on the Earth will be bigger, and hence I will satisfy the observations. Brilliant solution. This Ibn Shatir was also a muwaqqit, another miqati, from Damascus. He was living in the Umayyad mosque. But look who thought that this was a brilliant solution. About 100, 200 years later, Copernicus actually describes the movements of the moon in this fashion. He says we have to have for the moon two epicycles arranged in this fashion so that at 90 degrees it's like that. It's identical, curve to curve, circle to circle, angle to angle, to that of Ibn Shatir. And for those who would think that Copernicus heliocentrism will make a difference, in this case, forget it. The moon is an earth-bound system, and hence it is an earth-bound body. It's a geocentric body. And what Copernicus had done here, as you can see, is take the identical model that was proposed by Ibn Shatir about 200 years earlier, and use it for exactly to solve the same problem that was. So, and both of them were objecting. Notice this model, both of them were objecting to the old Greek tradition. So here we begin to see the very first fruit of what it meant for the Arabic Islamic tradition to actually create alternative mathematics to that that was inherited from the Greek tradition. Another astronomer, also from Damascus, by the name of Muayyad ad-Din al-Urdi, says also that the movement of the upper planets, where we have this equant business, meaning the axis around which everything should be moving, but it is not the center of the sphere, that equant in here, he says we can adjust for it by introducing a new mathematical theorem, plug it in here, and now readjust these so that with a small epicycle here, I can make the planet move as if it is moving around the equant, but in reality, it is moving around its own center, and this one is moving around its own center. Hence, we don't violate the physics, but we meet the same requirement. This is this lemma, this mathematics here is called the lemma of Muayyaddin al-Urdi, and as I said, Urdi is from Damascus and died 1266. Who inherits the same model? Also Copernicus. He inherits the same Urdi model, as you can see, between this and that is identical, and this one is embedded in the work of Copernicus in the De Revolutionibus. Now, it is not Copernicus who is raising the question now, it is Kepler. Remember Kepler, who comes about 50 years after Copernicus. He writes to his own teacher, Maestlin, and this is in an article that was published by Tony Grafton, and the full reference you have it here, just add 1973 to it. Kepler writes to his teacher, Maestlin, and he says, there is this construction in the Revolutionibus of Ptolemy, of Copernicus, that is left without proof. So it is the teacher who writes back to Kepler, meaning Maestlin, who says it's very simple, I can show you that this, if this line is equal to that line, then alpha d will always be parallel to cz, meaning that the planet will always look like it is running around the equant, i.e. exactly he explains to him the Urdi lemma. So now, keep track of it. We have the same identical model of the moon between Ibn Shatr and Copernicus. Now we have the same identical model between the work of Urdi and the work of Copernicus. We go on with the planet Mercury, which is a little bit more difficult to visualize its motions because it's very close to the sun. And hence Ptolemy actually made very good observations for it and made the same techniques he used for the moon. He noticed that the epicycle of Mercury, meaning Mercury will have maximum elongations, when it is about 120 degrees away from its apogee for an observer here on the Earth. And the way to make something look big is to bring it closer. So you notice this, the plot of the centers of the epicycle begins to look like an egg shape here, because at this point he wanted it to be very close to the Earth, and hence the blue angle in here, which encompasses the same circle, as you see it there, is larger than the red, and I fitted them here proportionally so that you would see it. So Ptolemy's suggestion was to do that. But again, what did it do? It had this crank mechanism by bringing an object a little bit closer. Ibn Shatr said, no, we can do it better. And the way we can do this is that we can actually allow the orbit of Mercury itself to shrink and expand. And he begins with a small orbit in here, and he shrinks it by a mechanism that you can... Oops, this is dying, I think. No, it's not dying. I don't know if you can... maybe I can point it... Yeah, he uses a mechanism here that we will call it the Tusi couple. In a little while I'll explain what it is. But notice that the orbit of Mercury can actually be made to look... It can be made very large and very small, but for an observer here on the Earth, and here I want you to pay very close attention to it. For an observer here on the Earth, the blue angle that you see right in here, that blue angle is still larger than the red angle, despite the fact that the blue angle encompasses a circle that is now in absolute value smaller than the other circle. What does that mean? It means that the smaller circle, i.e. the smaller orbit that the Mercury has in this position is closer to the Earth than the one at this position, and hence it will give the same effect of the blue angle being larger than the red angle, and hence satisfies the observation that Ptolemy had done before. So now, this trick, meaning the trick of making things look bigger when you bring them closer, and look smaller when they are away, that is the trick that actually misled Copernicus to make the following statement. By the way, Copernicus uses exactly the same model of Ibn Shatr, but he describes it in the following fashion as you see it there. In his own words, he says at the top, but this combination of circles, although adequate to the other planets, is not adequate to Mercury, because when the Earth is in the views of the apses mentioned above, the planet appears, and that's the mistake. meaning the apparent size of the orbit of the planet. The planet appears to move by traversing a far smaller circumference. And on the other hand, when the Earth is at quadrature, i.e. at 90 degrees from the apsis, by traversing a far larger circumference than the proportion of the circuit just given permits. So what Copernicus seems to have understood is that the absolute size of that circle that is larger, it actually appears to the observer to be so, when in fact it is not the case. What appears to the observer is that this smaller circle is larger as surrounded by the blue angle. So Noel Sverdlov, who translated and edited the earliest astronomical work of Copernicus, that's called the Commentariolus, makes the following comment right after this one. He says, Copernicus apparently does not realize that the model was designed not to give Mercury a largest orbit when the Earth is 90 degrees from the apsidal line, but to produce the greatest elongations when the Earth is from the plus or minus 120 degrees from the line of apsis. I.e., in the Commentariolus now, this larger size of 120 that is preserved by Ibn Shatir in here is lost to Copernicus. He doesn't seem to understand it. The conclusion that Sverdlov draws from this, he says this misunderstanding must mean that Copernicus did not know the relation of the model to Mercury's apparent motion. Thus, it could hardly be his own invention. For if it were, he would certainly have described his fundamental purpose rather than write the absurd statement that Mercury appears to move in a larger orbit when the Earth is 90 degrees from the apsidal line. The only alternative, therefore, is that he copied it without fully understanding what it was really about. Since it is Ibn Shatir's model, we know that, this is further evidence and perhaps the best evidence that Copernicus was in fact copying without fully understanding from one other source, without full understanding from some other source, and his source would be an yet unknown transmission to the west of Ibn Shatir's planetary theory. In layman's language, what Sverdlov is saying is when Copernicus gets it right and Ibn Shatir gets it right, you can say this is accidental and coincidental discoveries by both brilliant scientists. But when one scientist like Ibn Shatir gets it right and accounts for the observations and describes the motion correctly, and then somebody else uses the same model and describes it erroneously, then the one who made the error is the one responsible now for the transmission. So we can say now, with Sverdlov, that indeed it must have been that Copernicus saw the model, did not understand it very well, tried to incorporate it, and made the mistake that he made. So mistakes sometimes are considerably more important than correct answers in tracing matters of influence in astronomical texts. Now, in the works of Ibn Shatir, as we just said, he used this mechanism of making the orbit of Mercury look bigger here, smaller there, and so on. This act of shrinking and expanding is used, this mechanism that we now call the Toosey couple. By the way, the next time when you see those very nice charts that Dr. Farooq Al-Baz yesterday showed us on the face of the moon, and there is one little pond that is called Nasir al-Din Pond. It's not Nasir, it is Nasir al-Din. So correct them as soon as you get to see them. The person who actually created the mechanism that allows this expansion and shrinking, and the mechanism is simply a process of allowing all motions to remain circular motions, but at the same time to produce linear motion, is a man by the name of Nasir al-Din al-Tusi. And let me demonstrate. What we have in here, and we will need it for other purposes too, is two circles. One of them, actually two spheres, but represented here in circle. One of them is half the size of the other, and inner tangent inside on one here. And if we allow the outside sphere to move at a uniform speed, counterclockwise at specific speed, and the inner one to move backwards at twice that speed, that point of tangency will oscillate up and down the diameter, i.e. we will create linear motion as a result of two circular motions. Let me run it for you so that you will be convinced. You see how these motions, two circular motions, will produce a linear motion that is represented with the red circle that you see, with the red dot that you see it right in here. Nasir al-Din al-Tusi proposed this in the year, he died in 1274, but he proposed it in the year 1247 first, and then in this fashion, he proved it in the year 1259, that indeed this point H will remain along the line AB, meaning he produced a mathematical proof for it. Now who comes and does the same thing? Copernicus needed the very same mechanism as we saw in the planet Mercury. He needed to use it for the planet Mercury, so he wanted to prove it as well. And this is the proof in the work of Copernicus. But the late Willy Hartner of Germany noticed something very interesting. He noticed that when the Arabic has Aleph here, the Latin has A. The Arabic has Ba, the Latin has B. The Arabic has Jim, the Latin has G. Arabic has Ha, the letter has H. The Arabic has Dal, the Latin has D. He says, wait a minute. If I ask you to draw a triangle ABC, you put ABC wherever you want. Why are you putting them in exactly the same spot where they were put by Nasir al-Din al-Tusi 200 years earlier? With one variation, that this letter Zain here is rendered as F over there, which simply means to us also mistakes are extremely useful. It means to us that somebody misread Zain and Zain, these are the way Zains are written in the Arabic, and this is a Fa. So you can see the similarity between this Fa, this Zain, or this. And here somebody misread the Zain as an F, and that's how it went into the Copernican proof. All this is well known, and we know all about it, and it's extensively documented. I've been writing about this all for the last 20 years or so. But I also want to warn everybody that this does not, all of this embedding of the mathematics that was developed in the Islamic civilization within the works of Copernicus so far, this does not at all lessen the importance of Copernicus' hypotheses of heliocentrism. And I say hypotheses because at the time of Copernicus, he had no way of proving that heliocentrism works, that actually there is physical evidence for it. He had no physical evidence for that proof. So he hypothesized it in the same way, by the way, that Aristarchus of Samos hypothesized it 300 years BC. And for the same reasons where Aristarchus' heliocentrism was discarded because cosmologically it didn't make sense, the Copernican proposition was also considered to be a hypothesis, and only after Newton it began to make sense. So the idea of heliocentrism should be treated with extreme care at this point, and it has nothing to do with the mathematics that is embedded into the work of Copernicus that we are talking about. Similarly, I will say a few things now, specifically about the use of this mathematical theorem of Tusi in the works of of Galileo, but I preface that to say that once you get the mathematics right, and if Copernicus had got them right, and it becomes an easy matter mathematically to move the fixed center from the Earth to the Sun. In the case of Galileo, we will see that this now begins to move a little bit beyond the realm of the of astronomy and goes now into the realm of physics. In the case of Galileo also, what I will say about Galileo now is not to undermine or to lessen the importance of what Galileo has discovered with his telescope. That is an achievement that is unparalleled, and I think it remains at the very top of those productions. But we are also interested in how those great scientists of the Renaissance, how was their formation, how was their mental attitude, and what was their scientific education at the time when they were doing that? I would actually begin to actually look at the works of Galileo that very few people read, Most Galileo readers simply go to the dialogue between the two systems, where you have the preference between the Ptolemaic versus the Copernican. But the earlier writings of Galileo that tell us a whole lot on what he was educated with is particularly the work that is called De Moto Antiquora, which is a work devoted to the problem of motion, has the following statement. In a chapter in that work, it says, in which he now is describing, and notice here it is still in Latin at the time, in his early childhood, he was writing that, he said, it is demonstrated against Aristotle, so he's now attacking Aristotle. He says it is against Aristotle and the common way of thinking that at the turning point, no rest is given. Aristotle and those who believe Aristotle believe that two contrary motion, he calls contraries, those things that tend towards contrary limits, can in no way be continuous, and for that reason, and when a stone is impelled upwards and then comes back along the same line, at the turning point it is necessarily at rest. What is he talking about? This is an old problem that was encountered between Plato and Aristotle. Plato says, if you have a huge stone that you are dropping it from a high building, and you have a small pebble, that you toss it against that stone, that pebble will reverse direction when it meets that stone without a change, meaning without reaching a moment of rest, because it will be compelled by the huge stone to reverse its direction. Hence, there is no moment of rest. Aristotle says, no, it's impossible for any movement that goes upwards and then reverses its direction, there must be a moment of rest at that point. So Galileo says, I am against Aristotle in this particular argument, and he offers three arguments as to the evidence that he has against Aristotle. In the third argument, as you see it here, look what he says. He says a third argument can be taken from a certain rectilinear motion. Remember that linear motion that Nicholas Copernicus, in his De Revolutionibus, compounds from two circular motions. Remember the tusi couple, the circular motion producing linear motion. For there, he says, there are two circles, one of which is carried on the circumference of the other, and when one is moved more swiftly than the other, a mark on the circumference of the slower is carried along a straight line and runs back and forth along it continuously, and yet it cannot be said that it is at rest at the extremity, since it is continually carried around by the circumference of the circle. What is Galileo doing? He's reading Copernicus. Which part of Copernicus he is reading is that part of Copernicus that shows linear motion resulting from circular motion, because now it can demonstrate that indeed you have a continuous motion, yet the red point goes up and down without a moment of rest. So Galileo uses this for his own physical purposes, but he borrows it from the mathematics of Copernicus, who in turn had already borrowed it from Nasir al-Din al-Tusi. So you see how ideas, once they get into a culture, you can't stop them. They just move all over the place and they begin to influence people all over. So what Galileo is talking about is precisely this theorem that is embedded into Copernicus, and here we can see that Copernicus also tried to explain it and to create applications for it, and then, this is in the manuscript, in his own hand, by the way, he scratched them off. He didn't yet adjust, he didn't yet understand its full power yet, but this is exactly the same Tusi couple that we saw, which we saw that it was first proposed by Nasir al-Din Tusi, as I said, in 1247, as a marginal comment on the work of Ptolemy. So here we have the Greek base, criticized by Nasir al-Din al-Tusi, with a new theorem introduced here, and I bring it to focus here, and it is proven here about 6-10 years later, in 1259, to explain how does this circular motion indeed create linear motion. So you see the story of this. It is written in a commentary of Nasir al-Din al-Tusi to criticize the Greek tradition, to produce a new mathematics, to make it more workable, so that Copernicus can use it, so that Galileo can employ it for his problems of physics. You see how many tributaries this scientific tradition can actually go in. To put it in context, and this is William Shea I'm quoting here, I admire this Galilean scholar. He always touches the basis. At the very end of his article, he says in 207, his speech actually at Pittsburgh, he says, we should remember, he says, we should know that Galileo held a court appointment, which is not like an academic appointment like most people around here. He held a court appointment, but more important, he said, to realize, for instance, that he did not use algebra and never wrote an equation in his life, not even in his private papers. This is the great creator of modern science. He never used the concept of algebra, never wrote an equation, nor did he use decimal fractions, which were first introduced in 1585 into Europe. This is a puzzle. When we study the Renaissance, we should be able to answer these kinds of questions. How come that somebody like Copernicus never heard that the book of Muhammad ibn Musa al-Khawarizmi, that is simply called Hisab al-Jabr as we see it in Arabic here, transliterated into Latin as algebra as you see it over there, and translated into Latin as early as the 12th century. How come this book was not read by people like Galileo and used by people like Galileo in the 16th and 17th century? That's extremely important to answer this question, and this is the burden that Renaissance scholars, historians of science, have to answer. I don't have to do their job for them, but the evidence is right there. You can see it, and I think they should be able to. Second, we know already from the work of Eclidisi, who lived also in Damascus, and from this manuscript in the year 952, that the decimal fractions were not only conceived, they were also designated with special markers. As you see it right in here, you have this marker that separates the units from the fractions. You have this much. So the decimal fractions were known from the 10th century in the Islamic civilization. How come that somebody like Galileo never heard of them? Now, let me summarize. When people tell you that Arabic Islamic astronomy was a continuation of the Greek astronomy, I hope you understand the size of the caveat that you have to worry about, or the size of the salt that you have to take in. You have to take it with a spoon of salt. It's very, very difficult to believe that statement. Two, when people tell you that the Renaissance was created in this effervescence of a European spirit that created things out of nothing, I hope that you will understand also that in every single corner, in every single text that I have read closely, and I hope that people will read the scientific text of the Renaissance very closely, every sentence of Galileo, every sentence of Copernicus, you will find is embedded in it a result that was already produced about 200 to 300 years earlier in the Islamic civilization. So when I said in my last book, Islamic Science and the Making of the European Renaissance, I meant the making is in this organic relationship that Islamic science began to be part and parcel of the thinking of the Renaissance, and I hope that some of this evidence have convinced you. Thank you very much, and I am glad.
بعض الزملاء اللي معنا النهاردة أنا عارف أنهم يمكن الخلفية الرياضية بتاعتهم for our foreign friends, I would like to just say a few words in Arabic about this lecture to some of the audience who I know came for today's lecture but whose mathematics are not perhaps sufficient to have followed the key some of the key arguments, and I'll just use Arabic for 5 minutes if you'll allow me. الحقيقة أنا يعني المحاضرة دي بترد على أسئلة كثيرة جدا أثيرت في لقاءات أيام الثلاثاء في مكتبة اسكندرية كثيرا. والحقيقة نشكر الدكتور جورج صليبة على هذه المحاضرة القيمة اللي بطريقة علمية مستندة تماما إلى الإثباتات اللي موجودة في المخطوطات نفسها أثبت فيها حاجات هامة جدا. أولا أن حتى من المنطلقات المتطلبات في الدين الإسلامي الجديد اضطر العلماء أنهم يطوروا حساب المثلثات في الجيب وغير هذا من الحسابات. اضطروا انهم يغيروا قياس حركة النجوم الثابتة، اضطروا انهم يحسبوا بدقة ميل محور الارض، معدلات جديدة وكل المعايير بتاعت الفلك جددوها. بس مش بس جددوها وحسبوها بدقة اكبر مما حسب في مكتبة الاسكندرية القديمة، لكن الارقام اللي وصلوا اليها هي الارقام اللي بنستعملها الى يومنا هذا، وبالتالي ان الدقة اللي توصلوا اليها حتى بالاجهزة الجديدة بتاعتنا ما زلنا نعتبرها هي الدقة الكافية لهذه الحسابات. تاني حاجة انه يعني من طبعا الدكتور ادى امثلة كثيرة من تحديد وقت العصر في طول الظل، اتجاه القبلة، حساب المثلثات الكروية، دي حاجة ما كانتش موجودة ابدا قبليها، رسومات البيانية بالمنحنيات اللي اضيفت الى الاسترولابات. ده ناس بتقول لنا في الغرب انه ما جاش الا بعد ديكارت، لا ده جه من فترات قديمة جدا. فاذا استنتج الدكتور الحقيقة انه على عكس ما يقال في العديد من الاماكن ان الاسهام العربي او الاسهام الاسلامي في هذه الفترة لم يكن ترجمة بل كان نقد وتصحيح، وشفنا ده في ترجمة الحجاج الماجستي والتصحيحات اللي عملها، ثم إضافة حقيقية منطلقة من منهج علمي دقيق. وابن الهيثم في الشكوك على بطليموس بدأ هذا العمل وغيره، ثم الإضافات الرياضية اللي عملوها عشان يقدروا يحسبوا الحاجات مظبوطة بصفة خاصة ابن الشاطر ومؤيد الدين العرضي، وازدواجية الطوسي اللي هي الدائرتين اللي جوا بعض اللي بيحخلوا الحركة الرأسية تتحرك سوا، ان ده وجد طريقه الى الاسهامات الكبيرة في عصر النهضة الاوروبية. واستشهد الدكتور الحقيقة مش بس باثباتاته هو الشخصية وهي كثيرة وعظيمة ولا حدود لها، انما استشهد ايضا بالغربيين نفسهم من سويردلوف اللي بين ان كوبرنيكوس اخذ من حسابات ابن الشاطر ما لم يفهمه بدقة، وان في اخطاء دخلت وتبين ان هو كان اخذ منه، وايضا ان جاليليو اعتمد على دخول افكار من الشغل الاخر، ولكن ان كل ده يعني يبين استمرارية فإضافة حقيقية من العرب والمسلمين، استمرارية في الفكر، تصحيح، ولكن يمكن إضافة أخرى اللي هي الربط ما بين المشاهدة والقياس مع المنهج الرياضي. هذا لا يعني أن العلماء الكبار جاليليو وكوبرنيكوس ونيوتن ما عملوش إسهاماتهم، هم عملوا إسهامات ولكن مدينين لإسهامات كبيرة من العرب والمسلمين، وما جاتش من فراغ كما يقول البعض. ثانيا ان يمكن اهم نقطة هي ان هنا في مكتبة اسكندرية القديمة كان أريستاركوس اقترح فكرة ان الارض بتلف حوالين الشمس، ولكن لم يؤخذ بها واخذ بكلام بطليموس، ولم تأتي هذه الفكرة ثانية الا في عصر كوبرنيكوس لما اخترع كوبرنيكوس هذا، وهذه كانت إضافة له. ولكن كوبرنيكوس لم يتمكن من أنه يشرح إزاي الأرض والكواكب تلف حوالين الشمس لغاية ما نيوتن أضاف عليه الجاذبية، لأن هي الجاذبية اللي بتخلي أن فعلا الحاجات دي ممكن تلف حوالين بعضها. فإذا العلم بيتطور في إسهامات وتجديدات وتصحيحات وتقويمات حصلت في الإسهام العربي الإسلامي في هذه الفترة لا يمكن الاستهانة بها، ويجب أنها تأخذ مكانها في هذه الفترة. وهذا ليس لتقليل شأن جاليليو أو تقليل شأن أي واحد، ولكن لنعطي لكل ذي حق حقه. فالحقيقة يعني ينظر أن أنتم هتسمعوا محاضرة فيها هذا الكم من المعرفة التاريخية والرياضية والفلكية والعلمية، وحتى أقدر أقول مرافعة قانونية رائعة بالحجة والبرهان، ودرس الحقيقة رائع من الأستاذ الدكتور جورج صليبة. فالحقيقة أنا كنت عايز أترجم هذا وأذكر.
I would like to add one further remark. I don't want you to leave this room thinking that those Islamic scientists, they did fantastic things and sleep on it. There is something very important. This kind of work is important to understand the Renaissance. We would like to know how did Copernicus come to the ideas that he came to. And we would like to know how did Galileo come to the idea. So this is a duty, not for the Islamic civilization, it's just equally a duty for the Renaissance, so that we understand it properly and take this national cultural bragging out of the picture altogether. Hopefully we will do much better than that. Thank you.